This episode of Real Engineering is brought to you by Skillshare, home to over 16,000 classes that could teach you a new life skill.
By the time we reach our 80s, our hearts have beat over 3.3 billion times and have pumped 250 million liters of blood around the body, enough blood to fill 100 Olympic-sized pools. Just 3 weeks after conception, the first muscle cells of the heart begin to contract and don't stop until the moment we die. It is quite frankly a marvel that our hearts can last so long. Pick up a stress ball and see how long you can squeeze it before your arm starts to cramp and tire. Unlike skeletal muscle, cardiac muscle has much higher numbers of mitochondria, which provide the vital energy needed for contractions. And with a rich supply of blood, it never has to worry about the buildup of lactic acid from working when deprived of oxygen. But just because they do not fatigue does not mean they are invincible. Heart disease is one of the leading causes of death in the world. As we grow older, some parts of our heart can deteriorate and cause some problems, but we have developed some incredible technology that has extended our lives. One of the most common implants in the world being pacemakers, small implantable devices that keep our hearts beating when our natural systems need some help. Before seeing how they are implanted and how they work, let's first see how our own bodies have been engineered by nature to keep our blood flowing. The heart has two sides separated by an inner wall called the septum. The right side of the heart, which on this diagram is on the left, pumps blood to the lungs where it is oxygenated and then travels back to the heart where it is pumped by the left side to the rest of the body. The walls of the left side are much thicker and stronger because it has to pump blood around the entire body, whereas the right side just has to pump to the lungs and back. The heart consists of four chambers, the left and right ventricles and the left and right atria. The atria and ventricles are separated by valves. At the start of the heartbeat, all four chambers are relaxed and the valves are open. Blood flows into the heart from large veins and the heart reaches max capacity. Just here, there are a bundle of cells called the sinoatrial node that are capable of producing an electric impulse that will travel through the heart and cause it to contract in a specific order. First, the impulse travels to the AV node, located here, where it triggers both atria to contract, squeezing blood out of the atria into the left and right ventricles. The electric impulse has now traveled down through the heart to fibers located in the ventricle walls that now cause them to contract. As the pressure rises, it forces these valves to shut and prevents blood from flowing backwards. You can see each of these stages on the classic electrocardiogram. The first little bump is the atria contracting, followed by the spike of the stronger ventricles contracting, and finally there is another little bump as the ventricles recover. For most, this sequence of events goes unnoticed thousands of times a day, but some may need a little help controlling their heartbeat. Sometimes the sinoatrial node's ability to set the correct pacing breaks down, leading to slower heartbeats or long pauses between heartbeats. There are a range of issues why you may need help, and this is why the incredible pacemaker was invented. And as with most medical inventions, it started as an incredibly dangerous and scary device. The first being invented by Albert S. Hyman in the 1930s. It consisted of a hand-cranked spring motor, which would store the hand-cranked rotation as potential energy in a spring. This spring motor then drove a generator, with these large U-shaped magnets providing the magnetic flux needed to generate the direct current voltage. The current was then pulsed by a rotating interrupter disc with four conducting pads, which intermittently made contact with a brush, which supplied this huge needle electrode. Amazingly, this little machine was portable, but it proved ineffective due to the low voltage output. His work was ultimately abandoned, but other researchers recognized its potential after the Second World War. A method of inducing hypothermia by cooling the heart until it stopped beating to allow it to be worked on during surgery was being investigated, but upon rewarming, it was found that the heart needed help with controlling heart rate as metabolic function recovered, and John A. Hopps developed this device for the job, delivering impulses at the desired rate through paddles that were placed inside the chest cavity during surgery near the sinoatrial node. The potential of using such a device on patients suffering from heart defects at normal temperatures was soon realized, but repeated applications of high voltages caused muscle pain and twitches along with burns, making it unsuitable for extended use. What we needed was an implantable device. Hopps developed the catheter electrode, which removed the need for open chest surgeries by passing the electrodes through the subclavian vein and into the heart. On Halloween night, 1957, a power outage struck a Minneapolis hospital, leaving several young patients without pacing from the mains powered pacemakers, killing one of the children and pushing famed heart surgeon Dr. C. Walton Lillehei to request the hospital's technician, Earl Bakken, to develop a battery-powered pacemaker. He returned with this device, a wearable pacemaker powered by mercury batteries that would launch Earl Bakken's company, Medtronic, into the Fortune 500. This was a revolutionary device, but the need to pass the wires through the skin was a constant infection risk. What was needed was a fully implantable device, and with the continual improvements to transistors, allowing for the miniaturization of circuitry, and improvements to batteries, this was soon realized. This was the first ever fully implantable pacemaker, created and implanted in Sweden to save Erna Larsson's life. With a rechargeable nickel-cadmium battery, which was charged through this induction coil overnight about once a month, it utilized some of the first silicon transistors imported into Sweden, allowing it to use less energy over older germanium transistors. All this was encapsulated in a biocompatible epoxy resin. Erna Larsson survived to 86, with his pacemaker being replaced a total of 25 times over the course of his life, as the technology improved incrementally. Current generation pacemakers are now smaller and more reliable than ever. Medtronic have even developed the world's smallest pacemaker, which is implanted directly into the right ventricle without any cables, and eliminating the need for the pacemaker to be implanted under the skin, which can lead to discomfort. Over 700,000 pacemakers are implanted worldwide every year. These devices help people live healthier, happier lives, and have advanced so far that many can practically forget that they suffer from heart disease. This subject is something I spent 4 years studying to work with, and I've worked in the medical device industry in the past with Medtronic. I am, however, completely self-taught in illustration and animation. I designed this logo over 3 years ago, and today I'm happy to unveil the new updated version which someone who actually knows what they're doing designed. I essentially just traced a gear tooth and attempted to make it look like the font I was using, with no real design experience. I may have fared better with making it look professional if I watched some of these Skillshare classes on logo design first. They teach simple things about shape, type, and color which I just had no idea about at the time. Something as simple as fixing the symmetry of height and width of my logo has done wonders, and that's the type of thing this course will teach you. These days you can teach yourself pretty much any skill online, and Skillshare is a fantastic place to do it. With professional and understandable classes that follow a clear learning curve, you can dive in and start learning how to do the work you love. A premium membership begins around $10 a month for unlimited access to all courses, but the first 1,000 people to sign up with this link will get their first 2 months for free. So ask yourself right now, what skill have you been putting off learning? What project have you been dreaming of completing but aren't sure if you've the skills to do it? Why not start right now and sign up to Skillshare using the link below to get your first 2 months for free? You've nothing to lose and a valuable life skill to gain. As usual, thanks for watching and thank you to all my Patreon supporters. If you'd like to see more from me, the links to my Twitter, Facebook, Discord server, subreddit, and Instagram pages are below.